Would you like to see handicapped people depicted as people?
Excuse me?
I think that there were a lot of stories in the film that fell on the cutting room floor because we made the decision to tell the film as kind of the story of a band of friends.
One of the things I remember was we talked about my getting my first car. It was really kind of, where did my liberation start happening? Where I didn't feel like a burden or a problem, or I didn't feel penned in.
I got my driver's license when I was 17 for my senior year in high school. And my first car was a used 1967 Oldsmobile Vista Cruiser station wagon. When I got my driver's license, everything changed. It was a part of driving that was like a great equalizer for me. It was like, I can do it as well as anybody else. And behind the wheel, no one knows that I have a disability. I can be out in the world and not be stared at or know that I'm sticking out. One of the best things about having a car was that I could go see Nancy without having like a freaking chaperone. We didn't sleep together until a trip I made to see her. She was going to school and living in the dorms. It felt kind of natural. We really kind of knew each other. We knew that we didn't have to explain that our bodies were different. We knew that.
Some characters' backstories had to stand in for others. Some characters' journeys had to stand in for others. And one of the things that I felt sad to lose was the backstory of our character, Denise Jacobson, because she grew up in the Bronx in an apartment building that was on the second floor, and she couldn't get up and down the stairs. There was no elevator. So she was literally stuck in an apartment, completely isolated. And she had a very vivid, powerful way of describing that experience of isolation and then the joy she felt in landing in the camp and finding friends and being able to roll wherever she wanted and having freedom.
I grew up in a Jewish family. And we lived in an apartment building on the second floor. No elevator. Nobody ever thought about moving. If you were a square peg, somehow you made yourself round enough to fit into the hole. I had no friends because nobody expected the kids to play with me. They all ran around. I couldn't walk into the candy store. And so I was really isolated. To call them back, but expecting to understand that that was just the way human beings were, and I would get so angry, but it was that way pretty much until I went to camp. It was during that first week I made a real friend. Because that was the beginning. I finally felt like I was a human being. I didn't know if I said that before.
We edited for about a year and a half on this project.
Yeah, our first assembly was of the film was about 2.5 hours long. A bit longer than I think that we expected at first, but like every documentary, it kind of reveals itself to you in a lot of ways. One of the exercises that we were really encouraged to do was to try to make a 90-minute cut. And it became clearer and clearer how important the camp was and how the evolution of these people's lives were and how to make it not seem like two different films, camp and after camp. In the long run, at least, you know, we found the right length of the film.
I think we believed from the beginning that it had to be a feature film to start with. The narrative structure was the power of the camp through to the passage of the ADA and seeing how the spark of the camp and the power of these individuals coming together was going to make things change throughout the entire world. The challenge that was exciting was how do we take all of this complexity and all of this history across time and how do we blend this really immersive footage that we had from the camp with the scraps of archival that we were digging up from all over the place to follow people across time, and how do we make that one story arc? Because of that, a lot of things did have to fall on the cutting room floor. We definitely had in our mind's eye tracing things up to the ADA, and we thought that the kind of end of the second act would be the incredible victory at the end of this 26-day takeover of a federal building and the enforcement of the first disability rights legislation. We worked our way towards, I think, knowing that where we had to end the film was back at camp, back where everything started, and kind of the resolution of the life journeys of the characters that we had followed. One of the things that got us there was playing around with combining the camp footage, the old camp footage, with a return to the campsite, and this incredible song, Sugar Mountain, by Neil Young. And there's something of kind of like a longing to go back to that place in your youth and that song that had the emotion that we wanted to end the film with.